give it a few more minutes. Anyone has a joke they want to tell them?
I can probably pass them all.
Yeah, that'd be good. I have a card.
So I have to keep one very, very clean.
That's actually, what's the other one with you?
Skull bear.
Oh, hi. Nice to have you. How are your kids?
Good, both good, huh?
They're grown.
Yeah.
But never out from under.
You're right, no more.
Yeah.
No, I don't talk much, especially one or two in the morning.
Yeah, I have one that really likes to watch us. One of these was the original pre-recorded, I don't remember.
Who's the original ink signature?
This is not.
This looks to be original.
Jeez.
That was what she had a sticker on.
Yeah, this is the original sticker on.
Oh, is that the original?
You can tell it's a wet signature, you can tell.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, one of those ones.
Yeah, well, I just, Cheryl said she had a sticker on it, and I didn't.
Yeah, we just, yeah, Cheryl's right there.
Yes, look at it.
Look, but don't touch it.
Yeah. No crayons.
I start drawing on it. Manlin, do you have 2 seconds after the blue over top? About not this.
Sidebar, huh?
Sidebar.
Non-related.
Yeah.
Non-related sidebar.
So we are not meeting to meet now, so that's fine. Conversation amongst you. $0.75?
Yeah, probably not.
Is this the only thing on the agenda tonight?
We have a couple of post-meeting issues, but yeah, this is the only application before the board, yeah. All right, why don't we get started? So thank you all for joining the July meeting of the Rollinsford Planning Board. In attendance, we have Kevin Haynes, Mike Rolo, John Krebs, our consultant, Glenn Chase, alternate, Sarah, our secretary, intrepid secretary, Carolyn Kendall, also an alternate, Patrick Alley, and John Hinsman. And me, Miles Inglin, the chair. The first item on the agenda is Madeline and William Cambo, 195 Clement Road, a proposed lot line adjustment. So why don't you just walk us through what you're proposing to do?
We have sold. We moved our lot line over 50 feet, and we sold the rest of the lot to Mark Wentworth, Suzanne Wentworth. That's it.
That's
pretty cut and dry.
So
and the monuments, they did the
It's not as cut and dry. You forgot one section of it.
What?
There's another lot here. So this is the three lots of record.
They're eliminating a lot.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay, I forgot
yeah,
that. All right. Yeah, we're eliminating our lot.
Yep.
And they are going to, we are absorbing our 50 feet, they're absorbing their feet. That's it. And I have a certificate of monumentation. Kevin came through, or his people came through. And we have granite monuments now.
Excellent, thank you. John, did you want to talk us through your technical?
Yeah, my first comment was that the first plan, and of course we put it away now so you can't see it, but it wasn't really showing that this lot was being eliminated. So if you look at the middle of the plan, it says the map. 146-1-2 is being eliminated, and there's a note over here, note 5, that says that as well, so that's good. Number 2 is the same comment. 3, that Kevin has to sign the final plans, which he's done. Somebody has that in front of them.
Yes.
Lenny Lord signed the final plans, I saw that. And then the last thing is that the certificate of monumentation. There's 2 bounds, there's a granite bound up on the front. The new front corner, then an iron rod in the back.
Yes.
That was set. And Kevin signed a letter to that effect. That's all I have.
And I watched them do it.
Does anyone on the board have comments, questions, concerns?
Pretty straightforward.
All right. think we are required to have a public hearing.
You are.
Okay, so at this point, I will open the public hearing and accept comments from the public. I don't see anyone. All right, why don't we go ahead and close the public hearing, maybe the fastest one on record. So first off, we should get a motion to accept the...
I'll move that we accept the application as complete.
Thank you, sir.
I will second that.
All right, all in favor of accepting that motion?
Aye.
Okay. If the ayes have it. So I guess we can move right into... Does anyone else have any points of clarification? All right. I think we can...
Just one question though. No standing growth is being altered in this. No trees, no stone wall.
No,
no,
our leach field. Our leach field happens to be in the 50 feet. We were in the setbacks, and it's always been a dilemma for us what to do with that. So this solves our leach field. We are now on our own lot.
So your leach field was on the middle lot?
We didn't know. When we subdivided, nobody,
okay.
We were pretty novice at this. And,
okay.
Yeah. And who would have thought that they would go that far over, but it's a big leach field.
Yep.
Which is a good thing. But.
Okay.
That's it.
This was the lot that was between the next year property that was for sale a couple years ago.
Yeah. No, we never put it on the market. It never went.
I'm thinking the other side of it.
The other side. This is the one that Dustin bought, and then Dustin sold it to Mark Wentworth.
I got you.
That's the bigger lot.
I got you.
And he just wants to add to it. It's a win-win.
Excellent. Any other comments? Okay. I think we're ready for a motion.
That we approve this plan for us.
Okay.
I'll second it. Third it.
You got that, sir? Uh-huh. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none? You're good to go.
What are we gonna? How's this recording working now?
I'm doing it.
I don't know. Are you? What's the policy? I thought.
I was told not to do it.
Okay.
Yeah, well, that's what's been happening.
Okay. I thought we'd change that.
We haven't officially changed.
Okay. I think that's a point of conversation.
We're going to have part of that conversation tonight.
Yeah. Yes, I hope so. Okay.
She's a current owner.
I'm a realtor. I've done this before.
Well, we've had a horrible problem with people not recording. No.
Yeah.
Yes.
You want that for the
record? So,
hi. Hi. Let me call you back. We're in a meeting, okay?
Yep, there you go. Mm-hmm. Okay. So keeping an eye.
This guy signed. I can sign the others if you want. I mean, that's the one
you need. I guess, because I'm going to give them to Mark.
Okay.
And then we'll keep one, right? So, yeah, that should be good.
Yeah, we should keep one. Probably
two of them. No,
we'll do
it. Sit down.
Three.
So let's.
No, we got enough. Let's go. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. The prep will be recorded tomorrow, so. I was gonna do that way.
Do you wanna take a quick, I guess you can step away.
So that you can see the.
Talk about that all over.
Thank you. Bye.
See you guys again.
Take care of yourself.
Definitely. We should get together sometime. I'd love to hear your voice. We've got ours.
We'll do a lot of times.
Yeah. Okay, thanks, bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
So we do get meeting minutes. I don't know if anyone's had a chance to review.
I apologize.
I did have a chance to review.
Simply.
Well, I mean, they came in my head, you know. But well before the meeting, it allowed me to kind of try and review.
They were long. They were too short meetings.
Do people feel like they're in a position to approve the minutes, or do you want time to review? I'll give you a few minutes to do it on your.
I had to do it on my phone.
Okay. I don't think we heard the pun, did we? Now it's just on Christmas.
He's actually, this is the first year he hasn't walked the lawn. Every 92 on the 17th.
No, he can take this on.
Why is he so lazy?
No. Is he gonna mow it next year?
But that was always his escape.
Because he has a riding lawnmower. Riding lawnmower.
Yeah, it's just a bag.
You don't come between me and his lawn and his riding lawnmower.
Not him.
You just don't.
No, and that brown grass this year is just not cut, so I don't think it's getting him as excited.
So I did get an email just before the meeting.
About the story?
Yeah. So I'm not exactly sure. Is she looking for the okay.
Of course.
And we have a copy of those.
Did you respond to that?
I have not responded to her, and I was hoping you would.
Okay.
She just needs to come in here with the plan.
We need to plan the plans.
There's a plan. Yeah, we need to plan the plans.
Okay.
So she or I will respond to that person.
Excellent. Okay. I didn't see any other correspondence in the planning room. So I think we're good there. So what else do we have to discuss? Policies and procedures, I think it is.
One of them came up this evening.
Yep.
Absolutely. We've struggled with this off and on for, I guess, the last several years that I've been sitting here. At least who files for the registry. Well, it doesn't really. I mean,
that's an ongoing discussion. Right. I've heard the people advised both ways.
Yeah.
At this table advised, you may record. I mean, going back to Myler versus, you know, how many copies they should present.
I think Tony Riley had suggested it, and John was suggesting for a while that the town should be doing it on behalf of the applicants.
Collect the fee for doing it.
We don't, and we collect the fee to cover our costs, of course.
Service, you know.
That way we're guaranteed they're actually filed.
Make us responsible.
Yeah.
So the filing fee plus a fee for someone's time?
Well, I mean, yeah, the town should incur that cost.
Right.
And you know, that's maybe why the town may drag their feet, not drag their feet, but I understand it's a poorly written plan, but this is not anything we haven't discussed in the past. You know,
we had a plan in place, I think, for a while, and there was some personality issues that sort of fell by the wayside, and here we are again. So.
But there's no written policy.
Correct.
Okay.
There is a recording and town map update fee. Is that different?
Is that part of the fee schedule?
Mm-hmm.
So it's called what again?
It's under notice and recording fee, and it's the recording and town map update fee.
And is that collected at time of application?
Yes.
It's part of the bundle of fees we collect in advance?
It doesn't say, though that's interesting, because if they get denied,
right.
I mean, you wouldn't record the plans.
But it would require a current fee.
But you don't get your fees. I mean, first of all, rarely is a plan denied. So, and I don't know any town that would return a fee if you were denied.
Right.
A site plan wouldn't be subject to that fee. It would be for updating your tax maps. I don't know who does it. Is it Cartographic?
Yeah.
Avatar,
yeah. So they probably aren't going to charge it. I'm sure you have a contract.
Well, it's in our contract, yes.
So there should be a recording fee in there. The only thing I will tell you is that Stratford isn't that bad to record plans on, but what we might want to do is consider if the town is going to do them, and I think the town should record the plans, there should be some language in there that if for any reason the plan isn't able to be recorded on the first time, the second fee will be charged. Because like in Rockingham, kind of the registry there is brutal. It might take you three times before you get a plan recorded. Stratford isn't so bad, but you know what, it's probably what, an hour and a half by the time you screw around getting over there.
I imagine that other towns, and I agree with you, and it should also have in their instructions that recording fee would be returned if the plan is denied, which doesn't very often happen.
I guess you could put it in there. I've never seen a town return fees. But
what do you see typical in other towns? Because you know more about that than we do.
A fee is charged.
It's recorded by the town.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I don't know any towns. This is the first town I've ever worked with that has recorded their own fees. Now listen, Madeline, I don't know her, but obviously you all do. She says she's a realtor. If she came in here, and I don't know who would record the plan at the town office, but if someone said, geez, we probably won't get to it until next Friday, and she said, well, I've got to close in two days,
yes.
We might say, okay, you can, in this case, you can report it. But I think the problem we have, and we have had a few, is we approve these things, they never get recorded.
Yep.
They're sort of in la la land. So
in that case, do we update our tax map? But don't.
How do you update them if there's not a recorded plan?
We can't.
So it's sort of odd. To my knowledge, it's only happened once, and I can't remember the details. But
for better accounting and administration within the town, if everything runs across our desks, then it'd be easier for us to maintain and keep everything updated and accurate. Transfer of ownership.
Well, the town will get when the plan's recorded, the town gets notice of it. So you get a book and page or a plan number sent to the town. But my issue, is just that, you know, years ago, when most towns required Mylars, some registries still require Mylars. The issue was, there were surveyors out there that would modify Mylars after they were signed by the planning board, and that was a big issue. So that's why towns would never let them out of their control. If it's a paper plan, the likelihood of modifications being made are pretty slim. But nevertheless, my issue is not a trust issue, it's more, if we take the time to review it, approve it, I want to know it's recorded. So, I just think it makes sense. And I don't, and again, if a situation like this comes in, she says, I have a closing, or whatever, can I get it done? You could say, well, we trust you, please get it done.
Well, the onus is on her, she's going to win the benefit of suffering from the policy.
But we went through a lengthy review, and I can't remember where the heck it was, but.
I remember it.
It was a 2 or 3 month provision, or I can't remember what the last thing it was. And they didn't record the plan. And then they wanted to revoke it, and we were like, well, how do you get it revoked? We never really, well, it got approved, but it never recorded, so it was, and I can't remember the name. So if we're, you know, both John Radigan and I agree that you really ought to be recording plans.
Well, what would it take for us to do that? I mean, we'd have to run before town meeting to change that.
I'm willing to change the planning board policy.
But then we've got to do it. So, and you guys know the internal administration of the town way better. I mean,
upon a time, the tax collector was authorized and agreed to record them on behalf of the planning board before the personality conflict made that unworkable.
Meaning but the town employee did that?
The agreement was she would get like a stipend per trip to
see,
do
I think
that.
That's a great idea.
It
Why
also
did we not
was,
do that?
Well, it just fell away. But it's a really good idea because she's the one who manages the mapping with Avatar, and so she needs to know what happens directly when it happens. So that would help that community.
The select board should have another conversation with her.
Hey, why not talk? What are we talking about? 3 or 4 trips a year? I mean, but this is Dover.
It's not very often. Every other week.
It wasn't very often. It wasn't a number of trips. It she just felt mistreated by certain personalities.
Okay.
Didn't agree with that.
Well, we all agree this is the best way to handle it. Town and making sure that these things actually happen. Just because we've proved it doesn't happen until that stamp is on at the registry. It affects lots and deeds and ownership. So, and we've talked with enough time.
If we want to come up with a proposal, we'll say that it would be a case by case. It wouldn't be once a week or once a month. If we're not approving things that often, or maybe we will start to. Who knows?
Haven't yet.
Right.
It hasn't
been run
into the registry by any means.
I think, well, right, exactly. So my suggestion then would be until such time as the business really picks up, if it ever does, we just do it on a case-by-case basis and ask the tax collector to go over and do it as needed.
As needed.
So perhaps the tax collector could discuss it with the board when she's coming
correct.
In soon anyway.
That would be wonderful if we made that note and added to the agenda so
yes.
Certain absent-minded select board members. Don't forget. That would be helpful. Well, thank you.
We're really going to change this, huh?
I hope so. I mean, if the rest of the planning board's amenable to it, I think we definitely should be doing it.
Really.
Right. But it's not going to cost the town anything because her time will be covered by the fee, right? We've got to figure out what the fee is next. Make sure the fee is actually.
Right. Exactly. What does the
right amount charge?
We're not starting any.
What does the county
personnel
charge?
Wards or anything?
Well,
assets on nicely.
What we got to do is, I don't know how Stratford does, but they probably what we probably got to do is say you got to whoever the applicant is has to provide 2 checks. I think they want one for the what's the fee? The
fee, the L chip fee.
The L chip fee, and then one for the recording fee. So we got to call the registry to say, is
schedule
one check
fees.
Okay or 2?
No. On the thing, sorry, that was not intentional. So according to their website, a $25 state L-chip surcharge fee and a separate check is due each.
Right, so it's 2 checks.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that means like Madeline should have written 2 checks to the Stratford County Registry. registry deeds, they could have been blank, we would have told them what, or maybe it's the outship fee is one and the recording fee is the other, I don't.
Well, the other one would be to the town for the recording fee plus the flat fee to the town clerk for recording.
However it is, but yeah, but I think maybe the new policy ought to say what, you know, how many checks have been made out to.
Yes.
And for what amount.
And at the time of submission?
As a condition of the approval, I think, I mean, otherwise we're gonna lose checks, you know. If someone's holding on to them for 3 or 4 months while we review something.
Good point.
They're probably gonna get lost.
Well, I would state the point that if it was something that could be collected after the fact, then maybe the fee for sending someone to the registry and recording it could be collected at time of approval and when it's be done, because I think that.
And then if they're denied, then they don't pay.
But if you collect anything upfront, that you don't have, that you don't address saying either it is forfeited or it'll be returned to you, I just think you leave yourself open if you collect fees that, like a recording fee for a plan that never needs to be recorded.
But we also need noticing fees regardless of whether they're denied.
But we get notice fees.
Well, right, but that should be due, I think.
Oh, those fees, yes, I think.
We need to break it all down.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the recording fee and the administrative fee to cover those recording fees should be paid at the time of approval. The other fees have to be paid at the time of application.
So we know that the outship fee is $25. Is that just standard?
Is it per page or is it per?
I don't know, that's what I'm wondering. So how do we know what the recording fee is?
It's kind of confusing from the website. So I think that LTIP surcharge is just a straight 25, but so, and then they're saying all documents, there's $10, $4 each page, $2 surcharge. But then at the bottom it says for plans, there are all these different pricings for sizes. Now does that mean like if I submit 4 pages of 11 by 17 at $11.50 per page, that's the cost, or
yeah, we don't ever. I mean, generally, I don't think we've ever approved an 11 by 17. That was probably 24 by 30.
I guess I'm asking, which fees are we?
How would we know what to charge?
Yeah.
Well, that's why when I used to do it all the time, I always said I wanted a blank check, and then I'd fill it out when I got there because I didn't want to have the wrong amount.
Yeah.
So I would rather say a blank check made out to the Stratford County Register of Deeds. You can fill it out, or whoever brings it there, and then they can tell them what the fee was.
And fees are subject to change through the course of the project, so.
Yeah, right. Because not every applicant.
You know, we may get a ballpark that needs to be increased or decreased.
Or how many people are coming with the blank check.
That could be worked through the deal.
It's made tables, no matter what.
Right, through the process, another down process.
Yeah.
Well, they may add plan pages too, so.
Or we can put the onus on the applicant. You know, a lot of times the applicant is represented by a surveyor or an engineer. They want to call and say, this is the size of plan that I have, what's the fee going to be, and they can give you the check.
Yeah.
And that's, we can put the burden on them. That way, if they don't want to give you a blank check.
Well, because then that gets a little dicey.
Well, I mean, it's not like
Sarah. They give you the wrong
check. It's not going to be made payable to Sarah. It's going to be made payable to the registry deeds. So. Yeah. But, you know, if people don't like doing that, then that's the way around it.
Yep, but a policy written up that described, that addressed each of these unique situations, then, I mean, it's a policy. If you look at the policy right now, it's not the case. Yep.
So who wants to draft the policy for review at the next meeting? Which end off the form?
I think that a representative of the planning board that frequents a select board meeting should discuss it with the select board regarding the town clerk's participation, right. And if that same person wants to draft said policy, I'd be okay with that.
Do we have one from another town that we can approach?
I think that you can, or else that planning guidebook might have a sample copy of a procedure that might be specific.
I mean, if you want me to write something out, they won't see me wrong. Maybe I'll just do it. Would that be easier? I don't think they're going to have anything specific in there.
Okay, so.
No, I do that. That's something that could be researched and found. I mean, it's a call to it in another town.
Yeah. I mean, personally, I think a professional would be best.
Someone that could represent the select board in calling another town. Saying, I'm going to get this one away. I'd like to know
planning consultant's already volunteered, so we're thanking him for that.
Yep, I can do that.
Excellent, and, but thank you, Mike. But I think we should do this, I mean, I just think, because this, and you're right, this is not the first time we've talked about this.
The other.
It would help admin side, it would help.
Yeah.
Perspective from the side, it would help us, planning board side.
I'll bring my notes from the Radigan training, that has to find, I'm gonna go pack at the moment, but, everything I'll tell you. He also mentioned, inaction around, subdivisions. I'm drawing a blank of the phrase he used. What's it called? Basically, you have X amount of time to do X amount of work on the subdivision, or it reverts, you lose the plan. Now, I'm sure I'm just having a, drawing a blank, I can't remember what he called it.
Probably called it vesting.
Vesting, thank you, it is vesting, yeah. So are we able to create a vesting policy? Is that, would that be part of, that would be part of the subdivision?
Yeah, I think we should, I think,
We control that.
You control that, so you want me to, let me look at our subdivision regs and see if they adequately address vesting.
Okay.
And if they don't, I'll come up with some language, is that fair?
One other large, there's a paper subdivision anyways, there's several in this town, but there's one that I know of on Rollins Road, the house for sale on Rollins Road. And there's an, the guy who knows, because I sat next to the realtor that's representing a funeral a couple months ago. And she said, oh yeah, you know, there's an approved subdivision with that. I said, oh, that's interesting. When was it done? And she probably lost some year and I don't remember it. I said, well, they've never done anything with it. But we don't have any policy that says that it wouldn't go away, you know? So, you know, just because it could be a paper subdivision forever, I guess.
But wouldn't we also want to tie in new plans that come through with investing?
Yeah.
You would be able to
across the board.
Yeah, okay.
Right across the board. Everything expires due to inactivity.
Right.
It's recorded in our maps, though, correct? As different subplots.
But if let's just say someone does a clog, what's his name?
Gagnon.
I don't know. Has he done anything?
He's put a road in.
Oh, he did. Okay.
So, yeah. So that to me, that
he gets a paper approval, doesn't do anything. Just sits on it, and 5 years goes by. The language I think that John Radding was talking about, that Mike was talking about, is after, let's say, 2 years. If no activity has taken place, then the approval lapses. If he puts the road in and makes a substantial improvement, there's nothing we can do about it.
Okay.
So
in that case, they've cleared down there and he's doing.
Yes, and those lots are recorded and it has actually been subdivided.
Right.
But I'm getting the impression from what you're saying about the person.
Well, no, I don't know that it's actually. The impression I got was it was just on paper.
That's a really interesting question.
Yeah, if you've subdivided the lots. There's no activity.
If you don't record it at the registry, then I guess it doesn't really exist, right?
But if you cut away through the woods and put a big cul-de-sac in there and clear
that stump
bit,
then you're vested as far as I'm concerned.
I think then you've started.
Of course you have.
Well,
there's been
a lot of court cases about what vesting is, and grubbing and stumping a road is not vesting.
Huh.
What the courts generally say is at least pavement, at least a base course of pavement.
Mm. Yeah.
But because, you know, someone could just go through the woods, cut trees, and stuff,
right.
And say, hey, I'm vested. Well,
sit on
it
for 10 years and sell it.
There's
an approved plan.
There's a subdivision on Arch Street in Dover.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Is it Elysium Field or something? Whatever it's called.
I do believe there's lots available.
By 16.
The guy that, you know, right? The guy that owns the gas station.
Oh, is that him? Okay.
You know,
he owns that, too?
Yeah.
But he put a road in. And it paid.
It's been sitting there for
a while.
I think there's still lots available.
There's
probably
one of them. Every single one of them.
Every one of them.
But my question was going to be, so would that be considered being vested because he put it in a road, that binder? I don't.
He did, yeah.
I mean,
it's not completely paved for all the lots, but there's an access, paved access.
And when I drove by there the morning going to work,
you had to sort of evaluate, you know, what's
maintaining
it. You know, what would be, in a typical subdivision, we'd have a cost estimate. Let's say the road cost $600,000. If he did $50,000, you'd say, no, I don't know what was required. So
I still think you're talking difference from someone that doesn't even mow the place down, period, versus what's happened when he's cleared and brought in gravel and underlay in his road. That's quite a difference from someone who's starting to plan.
Oh, and in this case, Mr. Gagnon's advertising a house for sale.
Yeah, well, absolutely.
I only used him as a...
No, but that's the most recent one.
It's a case-by-case thing, I guess, but at least there's guidelines to fall back on. Right now, there's not even guidelines.
Yeah, we don't, there's nothing in our regs, so...
So if, in like Gagnon's case, where there are four lots back there, whatever there are, that's been recorded, they're separate lots, you're saying after 2 years, if he did nothing, it would revert back to a whole lot?
Well, I think we'd have to have language. Okay. We have to have language in our subdivision regulations that after X number of days, years, months, if substantial improvement hasn't taken place, then the planning board would take an action to revoke the approval. I think we'd actually have to have a formal revocation. We wouldn't just automatically.
It just doesn't lapse.
Go away. Okay. Although, like, and I'm not an expert with zoning variances, although I'm on the zoning board in my town. Variances do have a shelf life, and I don't know what they do.
I don't know,
a year? I can't remember. 2 years, something like that?
They don't last forever, though.
They don't last forever. If you don't do something, you lose them. Right. And that's automatic. You don't have to do anything. But with this, it's different, because there's some sort of a measurement that the board would have to...
But as part of the approval, you could determine what the buy-in commitment degree is. Maybe it is pavement. Maybe it is,
well,
you know, if someone does these four lots and does nothing but sells the middle one, you can't revoke that. There's a lot in the middle. It's been.
You're gonna sound crazy, but was it Dover or Rollinsford? The apartment approval that wasn't Rollinsford. Up behind the Wendy's.
And
that's gone, right?
The ultimate plan, I think, was the whole protect the bunny thing.
No. Expansion of the apartment.
No, the bowling alley.
You know where Granite is?
Village.
Granite Village.
Yes.
That approval's lapsed. They got an approval to expand.
For additional back development.
Yeah.
They never built it.
So that one's gone. And now they can't. You're right. So that one, you know, and they spent a fair amount of time and money trying to figure it out. But, you know, I think if it was a substantial subdivision, 10, 15, 20 lots, the applicant came to us in a year and said, geez, the economy fell apart. You might say, okay, can we have another year? You might say, yeah, sure. We don't want to go through this whole review again. And that's typically what happens. Someone doesn't go through the pain and suffering of engineering and surveying a subdivision and only to say, I'm done. It rarely happens.
There could be a case-by-case review component to
mm-hmm.
Sure.
Like if somebody died in the middle of it and it's cut up and probably...
Yeah. Right. I mean, there aren't any situations.
Is there still that paper subdivision behind, like, the new Wolf Meow? Back in there off Howe Street?
That's Hall Street.
Howe, I think.
Those are all separate lots still.
Yeah. You know what I'm talking about? It's underwater now, I think.
It's not. Well, some of it is very wet and unbuildable.
Those lots are all sold to individual people?
No, the town owns them, but they're all individual lots.
Okay. With no development.
There are some houses out there, but it's a very small percentage of all the lots that are out there.
Right, because, I mean, it used to be a whole infrastructure.
Yeah.
Oh, well, the paper exists for a whole infrastructure, okay.
And if you look online at our tax maps, you can see,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Like light gray, though. They're pretty faint lines.
Well, yeah, and there are lots of teeny little dots for different lots all back there.
It is actually
town property.
It is town property now.
Has been.
So that's two things.
I followed it on my notes.
Well, we've been talking about doing this sort of a workshop on other things. And the only other thing I'd like to, at least, if we're going to, the next meeting, I'm not sure if Daniel Lynch is going to make it.
Yeah, he's going to try.
He's going to try for jailbreak, which shouldn't be that.
Oh, okay.
Is that the
lengthy of a review?
The
plans are about that thick of a gun in my office, but it's not that complicated. My point is that we have time for a work session afterwards.
There's another case. Paul
Therian will be in. The Silver Street subdivision will be in.
The guy wanted to take one lot.
That is it or isn't
two,
it a top pork chop?
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't know when then we'll have time to do this, but there's a couple of things I've been sort of keeping tabs on. You know, one of the things that one thing that did come up, and it was a shock to everybody, was the duplexes in the Gagnon subdivision. And, you know, we do need to allow a variety of housing types in town. We can't just say everything's going to be, you know, on 2 acres. But there may be places in town that, that duplexes aren't appropriate. So I don't know if that's worth, you know, worthy of discussion, but it came up. It was a shock to everybody. So that's one thing I think we maybe want to talk about. I think that, in my opinion, the Blue and Mill was a disaster. I don't think the zoning is great. I think we ought to maybe retool that. And I don't think there's any urgency. It could happen later, but I think that's something we ought to talk about is density, because I think the plan, the zoning board really struggled with how to deal with that thing.
What is the status of it?
Well, they finally got their approval.
Oh, they did.
It was just, you know.
Yeah, because we created a hoop that didn't need to be there.
It didn't need to be there. That's one thing. And then the other thing that, you know, we've talked about sort of on and off for a few years is Pat was a big proponent of trying to broaden the tax base. Mm-hmm. And as a board, we've talked about how to do it. The first step we did was to allow residential units in the mills, which I think, you know, I don't know. We'll see how that goes. And then the other one was Oak Street and the rezoning the Rollinsford side of Oak Street. I know that someone tried to get a variance for the...
It was kind of a
storage on that, in that house right on the railroad track.
They got denied.
Real river watch, it's dirty. It's dirty land.
I just think, you know, I don't live here. I drive down the Oak Street 5 times a day, though. You know, I wouldn't want to live there. It's getting busy. That may be one opportunity for some commercial. I don't know how far back, you know, hitting Route 4. But I don't know if it's worth discussing that. I don't know if there's any interest at all.
I think there's a lot of interest because every time you go to town meeting, people say our tax rate is too high and we need to, you know, create a commercial base.
It ain't going
to
go down Route 4, I know that.
Right.
Because everybody's saying that that's sacred.
Exactly. So what I think would be really cool and a bit out of the box is getting Plan New Hampshire in here to do a charrette and talk to the residents and everybody and see how people want to look at that. Because you're right.
I don't know how far back up Oak Street it should go, but I mean, you know, 200 feet isn't going to do it. I mean, if you went back 500 feet, then I don't know how far down Taylor Rental is. Maybe you pick that up. It's sort of, you know, that chunk could be commercial. It would have to be big enough to allow something viable.
Well, keep in mind, you have limits by that posted bridge.
I understand.
But that's the onus of the developer.
But if you're looking at ways to broaden your tax base, that's probably the only place you've got. I mean, you've probably done everything you can in the mill down here. And until something changes with the ownership of the mills or the
it's Route 4. I mean,
but Route 4 is
the white elephant.
It's not the white elephant. I think it's the sacred cow. You know,
it's
I don't.
The elephant in the room. That's where people drive.
You could do like the tail end of Route 4 where Cumbies is, right before you go over the bridge, and just allow like a small area on both sides since Cumbies is there anyway.
Slippery slope, I think.
Yeah.
Slippery slope. The other thing about Oak Street is I was on the zoning board for that, or still on the zoning board for that self-storage, and you know, a lot of residents on Oak Street say they're basically taking their lives in their hands, getting in and out of there, and you have to think about putting in commercial establishments there, increasing traffic flow, and people coming in and out of there. I think that's a decision not to be made lightly because...
And I'm not saying, all I'm saying is that I've heard for years that the town needs to diversify its tax base, and where else are you going to do it? I mean, that seems to me to be the only logical place. You know, if this was... other towns, you'd go right down to Route 4, but this not going to happen. So
if that was zoned as change zoning, I think there'd be very little. If that was all zoned for residential commercial development, I think you'd see a lot of houses on that go away real quick. I mean, I think there'd be very little residents down there.
Well, one's sold
on the left. Yeah,
on the road, okay. I mean, there's some classic old family houses. I understand that too, but you would be increasing traffic twofold, even at 4 and then even at you know, the Foss side, the Goss side.
I mean, Oak Street traffic is brutal. I don't know, it's self-storied, I don't know how much it adds to it. I mean, it's, it's wall of traffic every day. But,
yeah, that, and that road gets pounded. I mean, they're always fixing that road. And that bridge, I mean, it's just a horrible.
Yeah, I've avoided it at all costs.
So that's all I had, but I mean, those are the things we've been talking about, really haven't done much about. So I just don't, you know, if we could put those sort of on the radar, and, you know, I'll work on the vesting language and the policy regarding recording plans.
Yep.
And maybe, it sounds like the next meeting may be a little heavier than I thought, so.
There's an issue that came up at the select board, well, last night, it's going from a previous meeting, about signing off on building permits. Our zoning regulations, the zoning ordinance requires the select board to sign off on them. Is that common in most towns?
Well, it is up, like, I'm not trying to be insulting to Rollinsburg, probably north of maybe the Lakes region, it's common.
The very, very small towns?
Yes, where they don't have full-time building inspectors. But most towns that have building code enforcement officials, they handle it. So, but you're an oddity in the sense that you're small, you're small, but you're, you know, but you're stuck in this area. You know, if Tom Clark is, if you feel comfortable with him or whoever his, you know, predecessor is, doing it, you could always relinquish your duties to him or to her, whoever it is. But it's unusual. Most select boards do not.
Do not do it anymore?
No.
No, it's good to not do it. Would there be a reason to keep the authority with the select board?
It's a check and balance. I mean, you know, I mean, I'm sure, you know, the select board has made mistakes, I feel.
Sure, we probably have.
Well, with down the road, Mick, that was the big one.
Yeah.
Mick is right.
First year on the board.
Well, but Tom, you know, whoever is the building official is, could make a mistake too.
Sure.
As long as you have a qualified person in that position, I think they could probably do a pretty good job.
Right. Currently, we have Tom Clark reviews all the building permits, and I'm not necessarily advocating to doing away with the select board oversight. It's not coming from me, but there's a valid point is made that, I mean, we just sign off after he reviews them. We don't.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, most of you know me, I've been in the Lakes region for 9 years. I was a selectman in my town. For 7 of those years, I was a test pit witness for new septic systems. Right. I got a second. All I did was go out there.
We signed off on
into the policy, but they gave us $50 cash.
Yeah.
I'd go out on a Saturday, sometimes do 5 or 6 of them, pick up a couple hundred bucks, and I'd look in the hole and say, yeah, it looks good. Finally, I said, this is ridiculous. What do I know?
Right.
So we got rid of
the policy. We have Clark review all the septic designs.
Right.
I don't know.
Well, right. So, you know, I would think that a select board in Rollinsburg would probably have enough to do without signing off on building permits if you had a good professional dealing with that. So, you know, I think if you felt comfortable.
We would have to change our zoning board.
Yeah,
that's the one.
Yeah.
So.
And I think it's cumbersome, you know, for people that have to come and sit before the select board to get a building permit.
So the other part of that, though, is, and it probably could be solved just with a policy change. Could be a subsection there. The building inspector signs off on building permits unless there's an issue with Classics Roads, for instance. I mean, we are the final say on whether or not we will issue a building permit on a Classics Road. We don't have to give any reason for or against. Mm-hmm. Nope, we don't want to do it. Or yes, we do. That's the only thing I could think of, at least last night, why we would want to retain our authority to keep signing off on them. But I mean, I guess.
But the statute's real clear with Class 6 roads, so Tonda would, you know, or whoever, the building official wouldn't have the authority to issue a permit anyway. So if you relinquish your rights to the building official, you're not relinquishing that.
That right, okay.
You preserve that.
Right.
So I think it'd be
super. You may be convincing.
Well, again,
I've been the one who doesn't want to relinquish control.
I just know what it's like to do all the crap you guys have to do, and if you can get one thing off your plate, it might make your life easier.
So I think there was another policy procedure related item with the application process, because things were kind of getting.
The only, something that would be handy to have in writing that I rely on Sarah for is when applications are due for the following meeting. If we can have that in writing somewhere, since it's all governed by the noticing requirement, it should be easy to say.
Should be able to pop a calendar on the website even.
Or something, but so that I don't have to not know all the time because I don't know.
Because there's more than one different deadlines for different types of.
Well, and because I've.
Events.
The noticing is.
So standard, like, you have to have an application 20 days before a meeting in order for it to be put on the agenda. A complete application.
So if we have that in writing somewhere, that would be good. I don't know if it is part of.
It's part of something, I don't know.
Something somewhere.
So Mike had mentioned to me that there used to be a procedure, a planning board procedure document somewhere.
There was.
I have not seen it.
I haven't seen it in years either. I don't know where it is or who has it.
Because he claims that all that kind of stuff is on that document.
If we could get our hands on that, that would be fabulous as well.
He has another copy.
Claims to have somewhere.
He claims another copy.
Who knows?
Yeah, find it. The one thing I would say is I don't like having calendars. I'd rather have a notice or just something for anybody that's front desk to hand out to people saying that the planning board generally meets on whenever we meet.
First Tuesday. Usually the first, yep.
Because the zoning board I'm in, I'm a member of, they every year our town administrator prints a calendar of when our meetings are, it's the third Tuesday of the month. And then if we want to change it, it just causes, it causes problems because this thing's been circulated, all around town. So I'd rather just have you say 20 days before the meeting, and the meetings are subject to change. I mean, we change.
Yes, July, yeah.
So.
That would be good.
And if you could ask Mike to find this policy thing.
And he's find it for us. Do you imagine?
Well, he had a laptop at one time that died, and a lot of information died on that laptop.
There was a memory.
I don't know what it was, but I know a lot of it went away with that.
But he found this site and subdivision things for me when it was commissioned for him. I mean, when he found it. So I'll ask him again.
Yeah, date, depending on the age, the date of it, I mean, something may be updated. Does any of that ever change requirements like that?
No.
No, that's all controlled by the state, right?
Not
state governments.
Yeah. Well, we don't go by the state. We had some time to it because this is a small town, but we could compress it a little bit if we wanted to. But it's worth 20 days is good.
Yeah. All right.
Good.
Awesome. Anything else to discuss?
Oh, plug again. I got a call from Chris Parker. Is he making changes to that subdivision?
I heard rumblings that they intended to, but I have not spoken to anybody about that.
Chris Berry called me and said, he said he was going to file a plan. He wanted to know what we would require to convert those to single family houses. I said, I think we'd probably be tickled pink. So, but then I haven't heard that.
That was a couple months ago, right?
It was probably 2 months ago that I heard from
him. I would imagine this will require them favorably.
Right, that's what I said. I didn't think it would be a hard sell.
The one he has for sale is a single family.
Yeah, it's familiar with.
Yeah. There's no house, but.
No, I know. I'm familiar with all those things in town.
Yeah. I've been there.
Yeah. So that,
all right. Anything else? You were about to say something?
Yeah, I've got to look at my calendar. So we're still planning on the first Tuesday in August.
I will be here for that.
It's the 7th.
Yeah.
I will be here for that.
What is the 7th?
7th.
The 7th.
Okay, so can we change it to the 14th then so more people can be here?
I would.
I didn't find that.
Same here.
Is everyone good with the 14th? Okay.
Yes. John, does it work for you? Because you're the.
I don't have my calendar, but I'm sure it does.
Okay.
14th?
It'll work. My calendar right now.
You say 14th of when? August.
CNJ. Yes. On the agenda for next
August already. Yes. Coming up.
CNJ.
CNJ and Paul at the Silver Street subdivision.
Yeah. And possibly one of our Somersworth Road, probably not.
I have no idea.
I have not heard that.
What's that?
Somersworth Road is not being communicated. We don't know if it'll be on the agenda or not.
Have been charging.
The select board is not issuing any building permit. They can come here all they want.
Okay.
But if they need any building permits, they're not getting anything until the other requirements from the last set of plans.
Right.
Are taken care of.
Sounds good.
That's how we're gonna enforce that rule. I don't know how else we do it.
So this is instead of retaining your right to.
They're supposed to meet certain requirements.
Yes.
These were conditions they would have had to have been met. Now they're coming with a whole other set of plans on the same lot, or?
That's a good point in what we were talking about earlier, just to see things that actually do happen. You have to police the year out and the two.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're charged with actually enforcing it, right?
Well, right, so who would be that person to monitor whether or not somebody's vested, you know, a year or 2 years after something's approved? Or if they're following through with whatever the conditions are.
Why would we draft, why should we, if we get to this language, it'd be drafted such that the board has a responsibility, that the, you know, the applicant has, that automatically expires, it's the applicant's responsibility to come in and, you know, take care of, otherwise it automatically disappears. Without substantial.
Two separate things.
I'm talking about, sorry.
Promises that they made being completed.
I'm sorry.
They're not always gonna come up and want to modify.
I apologize for misunderstanding.
A previously approved plan that hasn't even happened yet.
I mean, like, so for instance, Paul Miller across the street, the garage there, right? There were certain conditions about not storing things. The neighbors have not been shy about coming to the select board and reminding us that those were conditions and we have to go and remind him every once in a while that he's not supposed to keep things there.
But he's on public display versus.
Yeah, no, but I mean, but we still, it's our responsibility. You know, it's easy to handle that, I guess is my larger point. But there are other things that we don't always know, and then when cases like Somersworth Road come up, this is how we, I think we have to handle it. We don't.
I'm a big fan of putting it in someone else's hands and trying to ease the burden of the select board. I think that's everything we know, but realistically, if we can put everything on applicants and if we can collect fees to get things that need to be done so we can pay a town employee a little something, something to run to, you know, Cross County Road or something. But it would be, you know, sure we can just say, well, the select board or someone has to go out, but that's, becomes costly too.
Yep.
And it, I mean, people's time is or something.
Right.
We're not doing it right if we just put more work on ourselves.
There's one other thing in the interest of full disclosure. Carolyn and I have been communicating about approaching the select board to get some funding to address the mess in the planning room by either storing, maybe you can.
Well, so really, I'm not sure what the remediation is, but we've been kerfuffled repeatedly by a request for information that we cannot fulfill because we don't know where our documents are.
Like digital copies of things? Or?
So that would be ideal, is to digitize everything, but it would make sense if we're going to do that, that we proceed from that point on in a digital manner so that we're not incurring paper after everything else has been digitized.
So John, do communities require digital copies of things too? Or?
Generally not. Yeah, okay. Even the city of Portsmouth put Dover, their paper, all things go to Bath and Lot, you know, they
so
have
then
paper
maybe
files.
It's a periodic expense.
Now, plans are, often are digitized, but like, there's, you know, you look at the plans you're going to get for C&J, which I think is a pretty small project. I bet you there's 25 set pages of the plans.
So
there's a drainage analysis that's this thick. Now, you could ask, that's obviously a PDF, you could probably get that digitally. But most towns and cities still require, paper. But the problem for us is that's just that everything just goes in there and there hasn't been an organization in the
but isn't that responsibility?
Pat's idea was to have like a couple of nights when we have a pizza party in there and everybody sits there and shuffles paper, but I think that's a more serious problem.
It's a way more serious issue because people have tried and then left it and then tried and then left it.
And I don't even know how it's filed. Is it by owner's name?
It was done by year and then owner's name.
Which
and that's awful.
Yeah.
So you can't find it.
Matt.
So
yeah.
It just needs attention, whatever.
You two are going to try to buy the plan again. Grant, it was perfect. Okay.
But that's required, right? I mean, is it required that we be able to provide information upon request to people?
Theoretically,
it's required.
Aren't we failing? mailing responsibilities here? I don't know.
Sure, but it's required that you provide information that's requested. If someone comes in and says, I want to see the C&J file for this application, we've got to be able to provide it. The reality is, you know, you can say, we suck at record.
Yeah, if we don't have.
That's what I say weekly.
We dropped the ball, we're sorry.
Go to the registry, you know.
They go to the registry, pull plans. If you want to look at, you know, submittals that came in with stuff, we may not be able to help you, we're sorry. Someone could sue you, you'd end up in Superior Court.
Well, that's what I look at, it's all possibilities.
If you're a person, say, Rossford, you suck, you know, get your act together. Then I, you know, what can you do? The horse left the barn a long time ago. I think moving forward, you know, you only hit your thumb so many times and you realize you can't keep doing it. So I do, and we've been talking about this for year and for years. I mean, for 10 years, it's been going on. So, but the problem is you can't just hire someone from labor ready to go in there and say, hey, go in there for 8 hours.
There needs to be someone with knowledge.
They need to know names. If it's filed by name, they got to be able to figure out what the hell man and parcel is going to. So, and I don't know who, you know, and you're talking about, I think you're talking about months and months of time.
Unless you could take everything out of that room and use the gym over at the grade school and lay it all out.
But again, you need to have someone with institutional knowledge of, you know, who is.
And there are duplicate sets of plans, and which one is the real one, and how many do we really need, and which ones can be folded, and we don't have flat drawer space for all of them.
But like you're saying, that can all be done for cost. There's companies and people that will do that to our specifications, everything, if we're willing to pay for it.
Well, what I would like to see, and I don't know what the cost is.
That costs money, right.
Is digitizing, and then we do it periodically. There's an annual cost for whatever happened that year, we get it digitized.
Before going, it's so much easier if everything is digitized.
So let me ask you this. So the Cambo Wentworth subdivision that just happened this evening, lot line adjustment. What are you going to do with those two sets of documents there?
I'm going to give one to Andrea, and I'm going to.
So this gets, she has this one. This is every case that, or
that's how we're doing it now.
Yes, and this is just how you did it. I'm only copying what has been done for going back 10 years at least.
Okay.
I changed this a little bit because I make labels now that have the date and tax and lot before everything else. So it's easier to flip through them.
And where do we store them?
There's a filing cabinet.
Okay.
It's not a great.
In envelopes like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
So every document, like in here I have.
But they're more searchable because they're by the tax map, the lot number?
You have to know the year.
The new ones?
Yes.
You have to know the year.
Yes. I mean, the older ones, I think, have tax map and lot too, but.
I don't think anything's left in those drawers. I think pretty much everything got pulled out because we've had a couple of earnest volunteers who half days into it, and then you have
not the stuff that I file. That's not been pulled.
Well, and the other thing, not to complicate it, but really, it'd be nice to have a central filing room, like where zoning board stuff goes in. Because you know, someone wants to pull.
The zoning board is the filing cabinet next door.
I'm just saying that you know, it's not the way it should work. In like the sleepy little town I live in, with under 1,000 people, we have one file on every property. If you've got a variance, if you've got a special exception, it's in that file. If you got a building permit, it's in there. If there's an enforcement action, there's a notice in there. A subdivision plan would be in there. So it's all.
How do you do it though? Like, I mean, some of those files can get pretty thick. I mean, how do you adjust
The average property file might be yay thick.
So what do you do with like the C&J that might have 25 pages of really,
something like something like that, you know, you could either have a rolled file where you can categorize them with 12 or 14, two, that you can say it would be an A1 of this, file. And that's unusual to get a plan set like that. Or you can just pull them apart and
fold them individually,
Which, you know, if it's 10 sheets, how, that's not that hard. But our average plan set's probably 3 pages. So on occasion, when you get a 20-page plan set, I would just pull it apart, fold each page, and put it in there with a binder clip on it.
That's something to think about.
Because the more chances to have to separate stuff, the more you're going to lose it,
I agree with that.
And flat files suck because they take up so much room.
They do.
You know?
Yes.
And then you can't go through them because the plans are so heavy.
Yes.
So I personally, I think for the few times you have a multi-page plan set, pull the damn thing apart and pull them.
Okay, so that's a.
Now you just gotta find someone.
Well, thank you. Moving to the basement, once the police move up, have it filled.
One step at a time, yeah.
Total joke. All right. at this point, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So
second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?